Good evening, friends. Welcome to Visionary Conversations. My name is David Barnard. I'm the President and Vice Chancellor here at the University of Manitoba, and I'll be your moderator for this evening. We're meeting here in Treaty 1 territory on the traditional lands of the Anishinaabe peoples and the homeland of the Métis Nation. The university, its various campuses, and the forks of the city of Winnipeg sit at the crossroads of the Anishinaabe, Métis, Cree, Dakota, and Oji-Cree nations. Our topic tonight is giving the red light the green light. Would legalizing prostitution change Canada? Canada's prostitution laws have been the subject of much debate over the past few years. In late 2013, the Supreme Court of Canada ruled unanimously that significant portions of our country's prostitution laws were unconstitutional. The court allowed Parliament 1 year to create new legislation. In response, Canada's government created Bill C-36 and took the approach that it would criminalize the purchase of sex but not its sale. Justice Minister Peter McKay has stated that this legislation represents a paradigm shift because it considers sex workers to be victims who need help rather than criminals who deserve punishment. The bill passed in the House of Commons earlier this month and is now before the Senate, making this evening's topic of conversation particularly relevant. Now, as always on these evenings, you as members of the audience are important contributors to the discussion, and we look forward to your input in tonight's conversation. The format is as follows. I'll introduce each of the panelists one at a time. They'll have about 5 minutes to make their presentation. And after they've spoken, we'll open the floor for comments and questions. Volunteers, colleagues from the university with wireless microphones will be circulating through the room, and they'll identify who speaks next. They'll hold the microphone for those asking questions. We'd like to be able to include as many people in the room as possible in the conversation, so I would ask you to be brief in your questions and your comments. If you would like to, you can follow our conversation tonight on Twitter. The hashtag is UMVisionary. This year, we're also introducing a new way to engage, and I'll explain how that works a little later on. As always, we'll conclude the discussion just before 8:30, and I'll now introduce our first speaker, who is a distinguished alumnus and current faculty member, Dr. James Blanchard. Dr. Blanchard is a professor with the Faculty of Health Sciences at the university. He's director of the Center for Global Public Health and Canada Research Chair in Epidemiology and Global Public Health. Over the past 15 years, Dr. Blanchard has provided leadership to the design and implementation of large public health programs related to HIV/AIDS and maternal, neonatal, and child health in India, other Asian countries, and Africa. He's actively engaged with policymakers and public health leaders to improve the effectiveness and efficiency of public health programs with an emphasis on improving the health of disadvantaged populations. Please join me in welcoming Dr. James Blanchard.
Thank you so much, Dr. Barnard, and thank you for those who invited me to participate in this. I've been told to be brief and controversial. Anybody who's worked with me knows that brief is difficult, controversial maybe. I don't have that much experience with sex work in the Canadian context. Most of my work is overseas. So I'm going to just give you a very brief sketch, which we can discuss further in our conversation, about some of our experiences. So on the screen you see pictures of women with whom our Center for Global Public Health has worked over the past 15 years, and we continue to work with these women. All of these women have a few things in common. Most of them are mothers and earn money to support their families. How they earn their money is illegal. As many as 1 in 5 of them and their friends experience physical and or sexual violence in the past 1 year. They are women in sex work, and they are among the most vulnerable women in most societies. Sex work is illegal in every country in which our center has worked. In each circumstance, the illegality increases the risk and vulnerability for women in sex work. In India, police crackdowns have dispersed sex workers from lodges and bars into unsafe areas such as streets, parks, bus stations, train stations, and other public locations. In Pakistan, protection from the police often means being under the control of pimps and other operators who take money and subject sex workers to unsafe working conditions. In Ukraine, sex work in many cities is controlled by the firm. The firm is a shadowy enterprise that controls where sex workers work and often forces the most vulnerable sex workers, such as those who are addicted to alcohol or other substances. It forces those to work in the most dangerous locations, including along the highways and streets and on the outskirts of the city. We as Canadians, we as global citizens, all have a social and ethical responsibility to reduce the risk of harm among those who are most vulnerable. That means ensuring that our laws focus on protecting them and not endangering them. The standard for assessing laws concerning prostitution should be clear. Will this protect or endanger women in sex work? But even if we get the legal remedies correct, the legal remedies are not enough. What is too often hidden amidst the debates, discussions, protests around the legal status of prostitution is the inadequate support for sex workers to improve their health, safety, and well-being. As an example, the government of India funds focused programs designed to provide a range of health and social benefits for every sex worker. The goal is to try to provide services for every sex worker. We don't have that in Canada. In South India, many of these grants go directly to sex worker collectives or community-based organizations, the very types of organizations that countries of the global north have tried to outlaw in terms of receiving funds. Canada can and must do better. A supportive legal environment is necessary, but not sufficient. Better support for community-based organizations who are focused on supporting women in sex work would show that Canadians and our government have a true concern for their well-being. I look forward to our conversation.
Thanks, Jane. Thank you, Dr. Blanchard. Our second speaker is Dr. Shawna Ferris. Dr. Ferris is an assistant professor in the Department of Women's and Gender Studies in the Faculty of Arts at the University of Manitoba. She researches and teaches in the areas of sex work and prostitution, critical race studies, decolonization, and violence against women. Her book, Street Sex Work in Canadian Cities, Resisting a Dangerous Order, is available this fall from the University of Alberta Press. Currently, Dr. Ferris is working with Canada Research Chair Dr. Kira Ladner to develop three separate but related digital archives: the Sex Work Database, the Missing and Murdered Indigenous Women Database, the Post-Apology Indian Residential School Database. Dr. Ferris is also working with Sex Professionals of Canada to examine sex worker activism. Please join me in welcoming Dr. Shawna Ferris.
Thank you. Brevity is equally difficult for me, but I will do what I can. I'm going to speak briefly on the following topics. First, the laws that the Supreme Court of Canada struck down last December. I'll talk briefly about the new prostitution-related laws that the current government is proposing. And then I'm going to conclude with a brief overview or discussion of whore stigma or whore phobia and the role that it has in preventing us from having what I would describe as evidence-based policy and laws around sex work in this country. So the laws that the Supreme Court of Canada deemed unconstitutional in December 2013 are commonly known as the Communicating Law, the Living on the Avails Law, and the Body House Law. And these laws were struck down because the Supreme Court deemed them unconstitutional in that they prohibited sex workers from protecting themselves. So safety and security of the person was one of the major components of that case. So these laws were struck down because they prohibited sex workers from protecting themselves by communicating clearly and precisely with clients, And in this process, sort of vetting or screening clients before doing things like getting into cars in order to proceed with services. And this prevented them from getting into cars with undesirable clients, or this, being unable to communicate clearly has resulted in sex workers having to get into cars quickly, communicate or negotiate around services in code, and then end up in a car with someone who's violent or being required or asked to do things that they don't want to do once they're in the car. The other things that they were prohibited from protecting themselves by were hiring drivers or business managers and security personnel, commonly known as third parties. And they were also prevented from living with or having relationships with persons such as romantic partners, dependent children, or elderly parents, because these people would be vulnerable under the Living Under the Veils law. Finally, the body house law prevented sex workers from working indoors, largely agreed to be at least a slightly safer space for sex workers to engage in their jobs or in groups as a means of keeping safer, right? Safety in numbers, etc. So the Supreme Court said the spirit of the laws was to reduce the nuisance or the neighborhood harms associated with prostitution. And they said that the extreme violence that sex workers in Canada were experiencing, the Robert Picton case in Vancouver being an example, was too high a price to pay for so-called neighborhood nuisance reduction. They gave the government 1 year to respond, and the government responded, as the president has already told us, with Bill C-36. And I'm going to quote just briefly from Pivot Legal Society and Vancouver's Downtown East Side Sex Workers United Against Violence Society. They say, Bill C-36 has been mischaracterized as specifically targeting clients and exploitative third parties while not criminalizing sex workers and others who may enhance sex workers' safety. In fact, they continue, Bill C-36 will result in sweeping criminalization of the sex industry, targeting sex workers, clients, and third parties, and will have the effect of increasing sex workers' vulnerability to violence and other forms of abuse. Bill C-36, they conclude, targets sex workers, clients, and third parties in various ways, and then they list a series of harmful effects. In the interest of time, I'm just going to give you a brief overview of the things that the bill proposes. So, the bill once again proposes to criminalize public communication for the purposes of prostitution. It also proposes to criminalize clients by prohibiting the purchase of sexual services. It proposes to criminalize third parties by prohibiting anyone from materially benefiting from another person's sex work. And it criminalizes the advertising of sexual services. So sex workers' safety would be impaired because it would be virtually impossible to work indoors when sex workers can't promote their services. So the government says that they're changing the spirit of the law. Justice Minister Peter McKay has called it a paradigm shift from nuisance reduction to the elimination of prostitution. It says, the government says, Bill C-36 will protect vulnerable and exploited people. The problem, and I suspect this may be obvious to you based on what I've already said, is that the Supreme Court has already ruled that the kinds of laws in Bill C-36 are unconstitutional. Even with the supposed paradigm shift, I imagine once we get to the Supreme Court again, and we will, the violence associated with these kinds of criminalization is extensive and already on record in the courts. Bill C-36, in short, is not a protective law. It constitutes a more draconian approach to prostitution than the laws that were already struck down. And it's a more draconian approach than we have ever seen to prostitution in Canada. So why is this happening? Briefly, whore stigma or whore phobia. So stigma, as many of us are well aware, is like an invisible but powerful social taint. It's seemingly impossible to remove, and it's associated with a severe social disgust. Whore stigma, or whore phobia, is a special disgust that is reserved specifically for people who engage in prostitution. And, as many of us in the room will also know, it's also reserved for just about any woman who transgresses any of the various number of sexual restrictions on women in this society. Whore stigma results in whore phobia, severe fear or hatred or loathing of sex workers or the so-called sexually transgressive. There's an immense national and international body of research that indicates that any form of criminalization of sex workers or their clients constitutes yet another form of severe violence against people who are already made vulnerable by virtue of whore stigma and its associated cultural marginalization. Whore phobia and whore stigma prevent governments and society more generally from treating sex workers like actual people and sex work between consenting adults as actual labor. Instead, any woman who engages in sex work is perceived by too many of us as tainted, as either partially culpable in any violence she suffers by virtue of her choice, however restricted, to engage in sex work, or as utterly voiceless and powerless and thus in need of our assistance. I offer a quote from a local frontline service worker. He says, "Over the years of working with persons in the sex trade, many have told me that they take pride in the fact that through working in the trade, they are paying their bills. They take pride in the fact that they can financially take care of themselves. When people label them as victims, it lessens this achievement. It puts a negative slant to this." He continues, "Why is it important to label people with something that in itself harms people?" He says, "If you're not a victim, the label will make sure you become one. Why can't we simply ask people how they would like us to see them? Are we not interested in their answer?" In conclusion, I suggest it is time to listen to sex workers, all of them, who speak out on this issue. It is time to look at the evidence, all of it, and decriminalize sex work. It is time to acknowledge our own culpability in the violence perpetuated against so many people in sex work. Violent offenders target sex workers because of stigma, their own and ours, and they do it because they think we won't care. Bill C-36 perpetuates stigma, and it's a travesty. In answer to the question in the title of this panel, if it changes Canada at all, I suggest it will change it for the worse.
Thank you, Dr. Ferris. Our next and last speaker is the Special Advisor on Aboriginal Women's Issues for the Aboriginal Issues Committee of Cabinet of Manitoba and U of M alumna, Ms. Nahanni Fontaine. Ms. Fontaine has a BA from the University of Winnipeg in Environmental Studies and International Development and a Master's degree in Native Studies, Women's Studies, and Critical Theory from the University of Manitoba. She's currently on leave from the U of M interdisciplinary PhD program. Ms. Fontaine has served on a number of boards and committees, including the Winnipeg Police Advisory Board, the Canadian Race Relations Foundation, and the United Nations Working Group on the Draft Declaration on the Rights of Indigenous People. She's the recipient of several awards, scholarships, and fellowships, including the Social Sciences and Humanities Research Council of Canada's Doctoral Scholarship, YMCA Women of Distinction Award, and a Governor General's Award in commemoration of the Persons Case. Ms. Fontaine is status Ojibwe from the Saguin Anishinaabe First Nation in southern Manitoba. Please join me in welcoming Ms. Nahanni Fontaine.
Anine, everyone. Excuse me. I just want to acknowledge that we're gathered tonight on Treaty 1 territory, and I appreciate that the opening comments also acknowledge that. I typically don't write anything down when I speak, but I felt that I needed to kind of try and get my ideas across as succinctly as possible. So when discussing prostitution, we begin from the twisted and insulting premise of prostitution as the world's oldest profession, positioning prostitution as a legitimate and long-standing human or male right and experience, consequently justifying patriarchy's violence against and claim over the bodies, minds, and spirits of women, men, boys, and girls all around the world. Let me be unequivocally clear. In these lands, these indigenous lands, prostitution did not exist within our territories prior to contact. Prostitution was not something intrinsic to Indigenous people's ways of being or understanding. In fact, there was nothing in Indigenous languages to denote the concept or exercise of prostitution. Indigenous women and girls occupied a very sacred, independent, respected, and equitable space within nations, territories, communities, clans, and families. Indigenous women and girls participated equitably within all decision-making processes and indeed fundamentally determined and contributed to the socioeconomic stability and equity of the Indigenous collective. Indigenous women were understood and constructed as life givers and as sacred. And as such, gendered relations were predicated upon this spiritual way of being and understanding one another. Indigenous women and girls were not treated as less than, or that their bodies were for the sole use of Indigenous men. In fact, most Indigenous languages did not have words for he, she, him, her, and certainly didn't have language for concepts or expressions of being less than or superior and inferior. So why am I starting at this particular juncture? Because I want people to fully understand and appreciate. We only see the advent of prostitution in these lands with the arrival of settlers and their commodification of lands and Indigenous women and girls' bodies. We only begin to see violence in its myriad of forms against Indigenous women and girls in the very strategic and methodical attack on their identities and their equitable space within the Indigenous collective. Settlers reconstructed Indigenous women and girls' identities from sacred, independent, and as leaders to one of promiscuous, whores, drudges, slaves of their husbands, and of course, squaws, which is the French corruption of the Iroquois word for female sexual parts, the equivalent of today's cunt. Settlers instituted Indigenous women and girls as the property of patriarchy and colonization. In this territory, we cannot separate the sexual exploitation of Indigenous women and girls without understanding and acknowledging the role that colonization, firmly situated in its racialized, classist, and gendered justification, plays in the current reality of prostitution of Indigenous women and girls. There can be no denying the vast majority of sexual exploitation is executed on the bodies of Indigenous women and girls and women of color in Canada. This reality is absolutely predicated upon the Canadian colonial experiment and the racialized and sexualized narratives constructed in respect of Indigenous women and girls' worth or lack thereof and their disposability. The sexual exploitation of and savage violence leveled against Indigenous women and girls is nothing more than the continued colonial exercise we've been dealing with since the advent of contact, erroneously colored with the discourse of choice or as a legitimate service industry. The sexual exploitation of, or let us be perfectly clear, Indigenous women and girls do not exercise choice in their sexual exploitation. Indigenous women and girls' sexual exploitation is firmly established in the colonial legacy of poverty, cultural and traditional disconnect, lack of access or opportunities to education, healthcare, housing, reproductive health, etc., etc. I have yet to meet one Indigenous woman or girl who, when posed with the question, "What do you want to do when you're older?" responds with, "Sex trade worker or prostitute." The choice, the narrative of choice circumvents women's or girls' lack of choice and the push and pull factors from which their exploitation derives itself. The only people who exercise choice are the predators, offenders, and pedophiles who make a conscious, methodical, and strategic choice to prey upon and sexually assault or rape the most marginalized, disadvantaged, and oppressed within our society, all the while justifying to himself with the ridiculous mythologies on why these women or girls are prostituting themselves. And so, when contemplating the question, would legalizing prostitution change Canada, I would submit to you that it would only further entrench the sexual exploitation of Indigenous women and girls within a space of a free-for-all for offenders, predators, and pedophiles who already do so. Legalization would only further forcibly situate Indigenous women and girls within the savagely violent space in which many Indigenous women and girls go missing and/or murdered, where Indigenous women and girls are regarded as less than, even less than less than. Consequently, I, like many of my contemporary Indigenous contemporaries across the country, prefer to see and lobby for the complete abolition of prostitution in Canada. I do not approach or know this subject from within a disassociated space, but have lived it pretty much from the moment that I was born, with my mother first sexual exploitation when she was 12 and 13, when in the early 60s she was forced to leave Saugeen First Nation and found herself traveling all across Canada and was sexually exploited on these very streets in Winnipeg. I remember some of my earliest memories was being left alone at night, four years old, wondering where my mom went. And while my mom was forced to participate in survival sex, she was forced to degrade herself on these streets to be able to bring food home, to be able to pay for her apartment. We don't often speak about the long-term effects of prostitution on the bodies, minds, and spirits of its victims. But for my mother, its effects were seen in the over 20 years of drug and alcohol use, or in her isolation from her family and culture, or ultimately in her death of a heroin overdose on the dirty floor of a bathroom stall in Vancouver's SkyTrain, or in her final autopsy outlining my mother's HIV infection. My mother, a beautiful, artistic, sweet woman, was more than a prostitute or a sex worker. I cannot tell you how much I loathe that language and that discourse. My mother was obviously a mom. In that spirit of sacredness, she gave me life that I'm able to sit here and still talk on her behalf. She was a daughter. My grandmother misses her every single day. She was a sister. My uncles miss their sister very, very much. And had she lived, she would have been a grandmother. In fact, I was 6 months pregnant when my mom died. She never got to meet her two grandsons. I say it respectfully. I know that there's a myriad of differing opinions and research, but surely, in this land, in Canada, we can expect more and we can offer more for women and girls. And surely we can expect more from men. Surely we can expect that men will make the choice to keep their penises in their pants and not throw $5 for a blowjob or $10 to rape the most vulnerable of our society. It is men that have the choice. And it is men that have to stand up in concert with us. Miigwech.
Thank you, Ms. Fontaine, and thanks to each of our panelists for these opening remarks. So we'll now begin the conversation, the question and answer portion of the evening. Before going to our first questioner or speaker from the audience, though, I'd like to mention a new engagement tool that we're using this year, Conferences.io. This new tool will allow participants to engage in tonight's discussion in a new way. You can submit questions for the panelists and rank questions that fellow audience members have posed. We'll be taking some questions from that source throughout the night. So our aim is to make sure that we're addressing the questions that are top of mind for the audience. Instructions were placed on the tables prior to the event, and we have something up on the screen as well. Follow the web address where you'll be prompted to enter the online discussion. We welcome your feedback and participation throughout tonight's discussion. So I would turn to you and look to you for your questions and comments on this matter, and a lot of material has been presented to us from the panelists, so I'm sure there are things to talk about. Who would like to begin?
Mike's not up. Hello, Tessie. Yeah. Yeah, I just want to thank you for that wonderful talk. It was very touching, and I was very moved by it. And I actually strongly agree with what you're saying about the use of sex, this idea of using sex for women, you know, prostitution, kind of lifting it up in a way that there's a real problem. It's a problem, and we're actually lifting it up. If we legalize it, we're saying, oh, we accept it. We're not really providing an answer to the actual problems of why prostitution is in existence. But I just have a question. So what I find interesting, so I, as a Catholic, have to believe in your idea of morality for women in the use of the beautiful gift of sex. Sex is a beautiful gift when it's with a loving person, a person that is in the proper right use of sex in terms of a marriage. But the people that use these and abuse these women don't have that. They don't look at these women as with a humane eye. They look at them with their own sexual self-interest and violence. So I don't know, like, what is your thought? I don't know if you can answer what would you think? It's really a moral issue that we're talking about. And I'm just wondering, are we enabling the problem? Are we just supporting the problem and not really finding the solution?
Nahanni, I think that's to you in the first instance.
I respect your Catholic faith. So I'm not going to really kind of comment on that because I really can't, obviously. And I'm not going to talk about the morality of it as well, because one of the basic premise of Indigenous teachings and culture is that we don't judge and we don't assign those type of social constructions. So what I will say, though, is that, I place fundamental importance on men's role and really which is the demand side. And so for me personally, as a mother raising two boys, it's my responsibility to be brutally honest in raising them and making them understand their space in their male space in respect of how they're to treat women. And so, in fact, I've always talked to my boys about this because, of course, as I said, this was something that I grew up with. And so I've taught my children about the sexual exploitation of women and girls. A lot of parents don't. We kind of just shove everything and expect that men are going to kind of learn this on their own. So I think that we have a real important position as parents to be able to teach our boys how they're to treat women and how they're to understand women. And so that's my little answer to that.
Shawna or Jamie, anything on this more general issue about?
I can speak briefly to the. So I agree that sex can and is in many cases a beautiful gift and it is when it's shared between people who love one another, but that is a very privileged thing for someone to have. And what we need to remember is that many of the people who engage in sex work, whether they choose to do it or not, do it because they need money. And until we can find ways to support people socially, to decolonize, to address the ways that colonization has affected Indigenous people in this country, Indigenous women and girls in particular, as Nahanni has said, until we can find a way to support people comprehensively so that they can actually make a choice, what we need to acknowledge is that sex outside that loving relationship happens, and we need to find ways to give people who engage in those kinds of sexual relationships the support that they need, the help that they need to get out if they want out, to not have to engage in it if they don't want to engage in it in the first place. But we really need to start thinking about the reality of what privileged people get and what people who don't have privilege get. So the question of choice is kind of moot, right? Whether or not someone chooses to engage in prostitution, they engage in prostitution, and the taint that we have in our culture taints them essentially for life. So until we can start to strip away some of that taint, and until we can start to address the things that privilege some and disadvantage others, then we're left with this reality.
Jim?
I think I got a little off track at the end. I apologize for that.
I think that one of the issue we're discussing is it has obviously broad social and cultural meaning. But what our government is talking about is a very specific legal remedy or a legal decision around this. And I think that it does support various positions in relation to prostitution or sex work. It is opposed by others in terms of their own perspective on sexuality and the expression of sexuality. But I think what I reflect on is that there's very, very few places, in fact, no places that I've seen where strict legal remedies is the answer. It doesn't suppress sex work. It doesn't reduce the number of women in sex work. It doesn't reduce their vulnerability. You couldn't have a more strong statement against prostitution or sex work than the Hudud ordinance that Pakistan has. And yet, every month in Lahore, a city of Pakistan, there's 600,000 sexual transactions between sex workers and clients. So even with a very strong legal enforcement around prostitution, it's not really having the effect that the society is trying to achieve, which is the abolition of sex work. So I think we have to disentangle what is the right remedy if the goal is to reduce the number of women that are victimized, and whether that's a legal remedy around sex work or prostitution, or whether we need to start moving the discourse away from the legalization to a wider set of discussions around what it is we are as a society in terms of how we think about gender relationships, how we think about race and culture and ethnicity, and how we think about social stratification. There's a lot of things I think that are packed within this, and yet we always seem to sort of revert back to a fairly heavy hammer of laws that are almost impossible to enforce, at least impossible to enforce fairly, and don't seem to have the impact that we're hoping that they'll have.
Thank you. Others? Miranda? Over here?
Not a touch intellectually dishonest to frame all sex work as the worst case scenario, wherein by every situation is the situation where it's some cracked out girl in a 7-Eleven bathroom doing overdosing, when there's such a range in sex work where you have people who are at higher class escorts, you have people who are exotic dancers, you have a lot in the gamut of sex work, and isn't it not just a touch intellectually dishonest to pretend like it's all the worst case scenario?
I think that's a comment, not necessarily a question. Anyone want to respond? No? Other questions, comments? Chris, down here. Else, were you?
Just for clarification, didn't intertribal exploitation of women take place well before colonization?
No.
No? No, absolutely not. I don't understand then the point of the question. The point of your question almost seeks to then justify the sexual exploitation of Indigenous women and girls, saying, well, it did exist pre-contact. It's, if it did, which it didn't, it's still not the justification to sexually exploit the bodies of women, Indigenous women and girls.
My question is prostitution not ultimately a health issue that should be regulated by health agencies as opposed to something like the criminal code? No one really touched on health issues.
Do you want to start, Shawna?
For example, the spread of, you know, sexually transmitted diseases.
Right. I think Jamie will probably want to comment on this as well. Yeah. But the sex workers with whom I research and the research with which I am familiar suggests that prostitution, in fact, is not a public health issue. It was framed in Canada, or in Canada's sort of mother country, mother colonizing country at least, in England for the first time in Victorian England. And the Victorian government decided that the easiest way to check the spread of venereal diseases through their armies was to check the sex workers who serviced the armies, because they figured the men wouldn't come in for checks. but the fact of the matter is, in the contemporary context, in the Canadian context, sex workers try as hard as they can to practice safe sex. It is in their best interest to do so. Whether they are there by choice or whether they are there, they are forced to be there because they need the money or their others are forcing them. Sex workers, it is in their best interest to practice safe sex. There are people in the room from Winnipeg Regional Health Services, and they would probably be able to comment on this a little bit more. But really what sex workers encounter is whore stigma and whore phobia in health service providers. So they are often unable to access the healthcare that they require, or often unable to get the sexual protections that they need in their work because of whore stigma or because of the ways that they're prevented, or at least the most marginalized of the industry are. So I really don't think it's a fair assumption to talk about sex work as a public health issue.
Jamie?
Well, it's interesting. I think that a lot of the resources and a lot of the attention that's been focused now globally on sex work really emerged out of the public health issue, the global HIV pandemic. All of a sudden turned a lot of attention, resources, focus on sex workers in around the world. And a lot of the work that's gone on in that context has been through the lens, or initially through the lens of public health. But the first thing that one encounters, I think, and I work in public health. That's my background. That's the work that I do globally. And a lot of our work is with women and sex work in different parts of the world. The first thing you encounter, though, is that health is a very low priority for most women in sex work. They have 100 other things that are more difficult to deal with. But I guess the second thing is that any good public health program doesn't leave it at seeing women and sex work as, you know, a group that you just need to sort of prevent the sexually transmitted infections and HIV, and it's sort of job finished. That sort of typical kind of an approach, I think, is becoming increasingly discouraged, I guess you would say. But I think the other thing is that the longer that programs are engaged with sex workers, the more they realize that there's a lot of other things that need to be addressed here. And particularly, I think, ensuring that there's more agency for women in sex work, that they need to have more of a control over their bodies, more control over their lives, more control over their partnerships, more control over their interactions with government. I think that those become the predominant issues. And if those kind of issues are dealt with, I think a lot of the public health issues start to become secondary or tertiary to, for the program. But I would say that, on the other hand, I think approaching work through the lens of public health allows you to not burden a lot of the interactions with your own perspective, your own moral or your own cultural perspective. And when I work in different parts of the world, it's not just the moral aspects of it. There's a lot of the cultural and other kinds of aspects, social and cultural aspects, that you have to be really cognizant of. But I think that the one thing about public health is by trying to take a more objective view of things, it does, I think, make you a little bit more prone to listening to voices and understanding what the issues are. So I think it's a little bit simplistic to say it's just a public health issue or just a public health response. But I do think that from a public health platform, a lot of positive has emerged.
Thanks. Chris?
I'm Denisa, and I'm moderating Conferences I.O. The top-ranking question is, if Bill C-36 does not achieve the objective of protecting sex workers, can you please specifically describe changes to the law that would protect those engaged in sex work?
Yep. These are the changes that were outlined by all of the applicants in the case that was heard before the Supreme Court. And basically what all of the applicants in favor of the striking down of the laws argued was that decriminalization is the model that protects, or that begins to protect, sex workers most directly, right? Using existing laws against trafficking, against rape, against murder, against exploitation, using the existing laws to regulate the violence, or to address the violence that sex workers experience, is a better plan, these people have argued, than having laws specific to sex work. Having laws specific to sex work, A, duplicates laws that are already in place, and B, has the effect of, as the Supreme Court sort of agreed in December, has the effect of marginalizing people who are already marginalized and further disenfranchising people who are already disenfranchised. And it basically gives them no way to go to police. I know many, many sex workers, and many, many sex workers in this country have been raped or have been abused, have been robbed, and they have not felt as though they can go to police because they often, and this does happen, it happens in Winnipeg, it's happened in other cities, they get arrested or charged for a prostitution charge when they go to report something else.
So you were making reference to the submissions to the Supreme Court in the case to which Bill C-36 is the response, is that?
Yes.
I'd like to also say that I think that the Nordic model goes a little bit further than what Bill C-36 has done, in that there is the decriminalization of women and the criminalization of men. I don't know why we would give a free pass to men that are sexually exploiting the bodies of women and children, but also the wraparound services for women that are trying to exit or needing those supports. You know, the government of Canada announced that, I think it was $20 million to whatever. We don't really know at this point where those $20 million are going. That's just a drop in the bucket to what we need to really deal with this issue. And again, I alluded to a little bit of it, housing issues, addiction issues, like endemic poverty. You know, in respect to the sexual exploitation of Indigenous women and girls, we still live in a country that in some communities there's not running water, or in some communities, you know, if you want to further your education, you have to leave your home community and come to urban environments which are entirely foreign to you. We kind of just assume that Indigenous people, you know, they're going to come to they should just come to the urban area and get their education, and then they're going to be safe and society's going to treat them as safe. So I think that one of the pieces is that the Bill C-36 needs to go further and more in line with the Nordic model. And again, those services, like that $20 million, is just a drop in the bucket.
Okay, thank you. Others? Shawna.
How might the classes benefit from the contribution of human slavery to the economic and political forces of gender war? How might the classes, A, B, and C, benefit from the contribution of human slavery to the economic and political forces of gender war?
Can you clarify what you mean by classes A, B, and C?
Well, in India, there's a caste system. In Canada, it's A, B, or C.
I'm just going to need you to clarify what you mean by A, B, or C.
Well, it's either the upper class, the middle class, or the lower class, A, B, or C.
Okay.
So can you repeat the question for me one more time?
How might the classes benefit from the contribution of human slavery to the economic and political forces of gender whore, I mean war?
I don't feel like that's a question I can answer, but it sounds like maybe you have an answer in mind.
Oh, I don't have the answer. I have a lot of questions. And I thought, even if you don't have the answer, what are your thoughts based on your expertise and your experience to help the community of Canada?
Any response?
I'm sorry, I don't have any.
I am confused.
Pardon?
I'm confused a little bit, I'm sorry.
Yeah, me too.
Yeah, I think we're all having difficulty understanding the question. So if you want to think about how you could reframe it, maybe we'll take another question in the meantime. Chris?
Are sex workers in Canada required to pay income tax? If no, then where is their work in sex work? If yes, then is the government as a third party not profiting from the proceeds of sex work?
That sounds like a legal question.
I'm not a legal scholar. I do look at some legal frames. Many of the sex workers that I know and work with do file income tax. However you feel that reflects on the government is not something I can really comment on. The partner of one of my sex worker colleagues helps sex workers to file income tax every year. But, I mean, realistically, the exchange of sexual services for financial remuneration has never directly been illegal in Canada. As people argued before the Supreme Court, there are all kinds of different laws around that exchange that make it seem criminal, but the actual exchange itself is not illegal. So filing income tax based on one's work in sex work is actually possible under the current legal regime and potentially possible under Bill C-36 if it passes.
Something to that. Sean.
Who you are and what your background is.
Karen Busby, I teach in the Faculty of Law and I do work on, some of my work research has been on sex work. So one thing I just wanted to say is you do have to pay income tax on whatever your source of income is. So sex workers or prostitutes would have to pay income tax or they risk being prosecuted for not doing that, another risk of prosecution. But something that I wanted to mention is a law that's not that well known, which is a law that every city across Canada has, and that's the requirement that if you run a body house or a massage parlor, you have to pay a license fee to do that. And for a pawn shop, for example, in Winnipeg, it's about a $500 a year license. If you want to run a smaller business, it's usually a license of $100 to $300. The most expensive business license in Winnipeg is for a massage parlor, and it's about $5,000 a year. So in order of magnitude, it's 10 times as much as any other business license that you have to pay. So the question that I always ask my students is, does that make the city a pimp?
I don't think you're directing that at the panel, though, right?
Good evening. My question pertains to the health protection. They always say that legalizing prostitution is going to enable them from getting screened more often. So how is that going to prevent them from getting the STI that would identify them as soon as they get the STI or sooner? But that's not going to prevent them from getting it, is it? Thank you.
Jamie, you.
I mean, I could explain in detailed epidemiological terms why it actually helps to screen and detect earlier. Because the sooner you're detected with an STI, the sooner you can get treated. And the sooner you're treated, the less infectious you are. So it actually reduces the overall risk. And in fact, some of the most successful public health programs for reducing STIs have been early screening and treatment for sexually transmitted infections. So it does work on a population basis. On an individual basis, it doesn't help for that episode for that person, but it means that more and more people are getting screened earlier, treated earlier, they're no longer infectious. It's like when, you know, if somebody has any infectious disease, the sooner they get antibiotics and become less infectious, the less likely they are to spread it. So it does have a public health benefit, and it does, there's plenty of research to show that it actually does reduce transmission of STIs, and it lowers the overall rates of STIs.
Thank you.
I'd like to address...
The question was, how does it protect the prostitute, okay, not protect other individuals that may come in contact with her after she's gotten a disease? It just expedites the treatment. It doesn't reduce the possibility for getting an infection. It expedites the treatment.
But there's a lot of ways in which it reduces her risk of getting another infection. Because there can be education about how to prevent the infection the next time. If she's treated, then her sexual partner won't be infected and can't then reinfect her. And then if the overall rate of STIs is lower, then the risk that she'll get an infection later on is much lower. So it won't prevent that infection, but it'll prevent subsequent infections.
I'd like to address the suggestion of the Nordic model, which has proven to put sex workers at higher risks. By criminalizing the men, you're criminalizing their clients and forcing them to go underground. By forcing them to go underground, they're far less likely to make reports to police, and the Nordic model is being thrown out right now because of those risks.
Well, that's a comment. Anyone want to respond?
Well, I don't know how far underground that they can go when men, predators, still can find them. They can't go that far underground. They still are able to be found by these predators. But I'm taking them to off the street. I don't want them there in the first place. But why is it not an option? Why is it that we determine that sex work is going to be with us for always?
You're assuming that all sex work is for sex work and that there's no sex work that's there by choice. I'd also like to point out that this is a panel on sex work without a sex worker up there. Thank you.
Thanks.
Mine's more like a comment and a question kind of rolled into one, a little bit of backstory to the question. I'm a visually impaired person. See, as I drop my hat. I'm a disability rights advocate. I was the Students Living with Permanent Disabilities representative here on UMSU for 2 years. I have a little bit of experience working with the disabled community. And on that note, I've worked with people who have been marginalized by society, by spit on, by just the worst things you can imagine. Disabled communities are just like every other marginal part of society. They get the shit. No, don't need to swear, but that's what happens. I've worked with people specifically who want nothing more in life to feel normal, to feel accepted, and to feel like they're just like everybody else. And sometimes that includes the ability to have sex. Some people have no option for sex. I mean, unless you want to wait 20 years to find a really kind-hearted person who just might want to sleep with you with whatever disability you might have that's been marginalized to your face all your life, that's limiting your ability. They rely on escorts. Escorts are lumped into this situation with Bill C-36. So my question is, to the whole panel, but to specifically Ms. Fontaine, shouldn't there be a system in place that, and a law and regulatory whatever, that allows a disabled, disenfranchised part of society access to sex legally and comfortably, as well as protects the rights of indigenous and endangered women in this country?
You know, honestly, there are lots of people in this world that don't have sex, that would like to have sex and don't have sex. And I know that I'm not the most popular here today and that tonight, and that's fine. I don't really care. But you know, when we talk, I mean, one of the things that I want to talk about is that when we talk about escorts or massage parlors or brothels, you know, those are typically not spaces that Indigenous women and girls are either welcomed or participate in. Because again, when we go back to that colonial context, Indigenous women and girls' bodies are considered less than, non-Indigenous women's bodies. So I'm not really gonna make a comment on escorts and those. I mean, I think that we have problems in massage parlors and brothels. I mean, I think that you have to look at the women that are actually trafficked there. But I'm sorry that some people are not having sex. I'm sorry. I know that there are lots of people in the world that are not having sex. But then to sexually exploit, again, one marginalized group, sexually exploiting another most marginalized and oppressed group, doesn't make it right for the virtue of having sex.
In that line of work,
again,
how is it exploitation?
I'm not commenting on escorts. But, you know, from an Indigenous perspective, not a lot of our women are in those spaces.
But then don't you admit that Bill C-36 needs
anything.
To be changed, though?
I'm not admitting anything. I think that
okay,
in
well,
Canada,
that's, okay.
we can have a better space for all women, that they don't have to sell their bodies or be put into spaces to participate in sex work. And as naive as that may sound, and it may be pissing people off, honestly, I don't really care. We can do better in Canada.
Thank you.
Actually, I want to just say one more thing. I remember years ago, I have two things to say. Your line of argument is similar to several years back participating in a community workshop, again, predominantly an Indigenous community workshop, talking about the sexual exploitation of women and children in this city, in Manitoba, and across Canada. And we had two police officers as part of our little group that we had broken off in little groups. And those police officers worked in the morales unit, as it used to be called. And they had started to say, well, you know, sometimes these men, you know, they're just socially awkward, or they just want comfort, or they're shy. We're all shy. We're all socially awkward. I'm the most socially awkward and shy person. That doesn't give me the right to then go sexually exploit the body of a woman or a girl. No, I don't think it's fair that you're attacking me, because I'm choosing to say that we can do better in Canada than sex work for women.
All right, I think those views are clear from both parties.
Good evening, everyone. My name is Amanda McMullen. I'm a staff member here at the University of Manitoba, and I used to be the vice president internal for the Students Union. All interesting points, but mine focuses a little bit more on politics and different ways to communicate with the government on this issue. So legalizing prostitution in Canada, and we're talking about Bill 336, I personally view that as a treatment perspective. Canada has looked at an issue, made a diagnosis that's prostitution, and are looking to treat the issue by basically compartmentalizing it. What I would like to see is more of a preventative approach. My question is, though, is how do people within the public who share my view approach government and say, hey, maybe this is a little bit more tied to poverty, the social and economic positions that these people are in, and how do we keep their attention and say, hey, prostitution is more linked to these factors, and it is related. How can we keep your attention and say, let's switch to prevention and not to treatment? I hope that makes sense in what I'm trying to say, but any recommendations? Are there groups already out there doing that, and how would you maybe approach that?
Who would like to respond to that?
I'll start. I think it's already been addressed in some respects or touched on. I'm a little bit uncomfortable with the idea that decriminalization or legalization of prostitution is going to solve things, because I've said this before, because I think it won't resolve a lot of the other ways in which exploitation occur. It won't stop sexual exploitation. It won't stop sexual exploitation for money. I think part of my concern is that on the one side, there's this simplistic notion that by criminalizing prostitution, somehow that's going to eliminate it. On the other hand, I think it's simplistic to think that by legalizing it, we're going to resolve the issue of exploitation and whatnot. And so I think it's become such a dichotomous discussion that's become very unhelpful and probably a bit unhealthy in terms of the discourse around these issues. I think, for example, and I agree that the sort of the rider of $20 million, which will probably be money that's already committed somewhere and it'll just be profiled as part of this bill, it's laughably low in terms of dealing with the complexities that are there, either for dealing with the underlying poverty and social issues that lead to exploitative sex work, but also I think it's laughably low in terms of supporting those women who are already in sex work. So I think I don't think we can give the government a free ride on that to say that, and I think that what's happened really is not really much of a change in terms of the consequences of the law. What's changed is the political discourse on it. It's essentially just changing the discourse from saying sex work is illegal and we're going to try to clamp down that to saying that purchasing of sex is illegal. It's just sort of switched things. It's, and I don't think that that's been a I don't think that's been helpful. I think, to be frank, I think it's cynical, because I don't think it resolves the issues that it says that it's going to resolve, nor does it actually follow up on actions to follow the political statements on it. So if there's real concern about women and sex work and supporting those in, those who want to get out, those who and protecting those who might be exploited, if there's real commitment to that, this bill is not doing it. And the $20 million is, I almost wish they hadn't added the $20 million, actually.
Thank you. Denisa?
Our next top ranked question, I'm just going to reword it a bit because it's a bit confusing on conferences.io, but are there any comparative examples that maybe from other countries that we can learn about this topic that can kind of shed some light?
Nahanni's already pointed to one. The Nordic model is a model that the government looked at before they put together Bill C-36, but as Nahanni has pointed out as well, they didn't really follow the Nordic model to the full extent that they could have if they were going to invoke it. And the Nordic model is in place, though apparently being thrown out, in three of the five Nordic countries. There are also a couple of examples that those who advocate decriminalization prefer to look at. New Zealand is one of the examples. New Zealand decriminalized sex work a number of years ago, and then they put in place a sort of a system of review at the 5 and 7 year, I think, points to see how they were doing with that. As another former British colony, this could be a place that we would look for a new legal frame. And the province or the, working on my geography, New South Wales in Australia has also decriminalized prostitution. And that's one of the places that we are trying to look at and study and see what's going right and what's going wrong. But I want to emphasize that I agree with Jamie that a legal solution is not a solution at all, right? A legal change is a small change, but there's much, much, much more work to be done. And in that way, Nahanni and I actually share some common ground. And you know, there are ways in which our positions are dichotomous as well.
Jamie, did you want to comment on that?
Well, as I said at the beginning, every country that I've worked in relation to sex work, it's illegal. Usually the penalties are much harsher than they are in Canada. Usually, the volume of sex work is usually so high that the notion that somehow the police force is going to be able to get out there and prosecute either all of the sex workers or all of the clients is... It's just unrealistic. Tonight in Winnipeg, there's probably going to be at least 1,000, maybe more than 1,000 clients with sex workers. And I mean, even in the most optimistic perspective from those who would like to clamp down, there's no way that you're going to be able to even touch a small proportion of that legally. So what ends up happening is that it becomes a fairly local political response by the police. Often it's an economic response by the police. And in many, many countries, it becomes another way of exploiting women, only through the police. In India, it's illegal. Almost 20% of sex workers get arrested every year. Not one of them is actually prosecuted. It's all about arresting them, holding them, taking their money, taking them off the streets, creating all sorts of social and other problems for them. And it doesn't really, it doesn't do anything about sex work itself. It just further victimizes the women. And that's true whether you go to Pakistan or India or Ukraine or Africa. That's the common experience.
Thank you. Over here.
Yeah, it just occurred to me. You've mentioned several countries that, the Nordic, are one would call civilized, and yet they have prostitution. It almost seems to me that they think that it's a right. I don't know, I'll leave it at that. I don't know how to go any further, but nobody else has mentioned any rights tonight. I thought I'd throw it in.
To be clear, the Nordic model is a model that seeks to abolish prostitution.
And actually situates prostitution as an act of violence against women and children, and sees it as a human rights issue for women and children.
Chris?
I have two comments. One would be, let's say we legalize the prostitution, then whether it's going to be like competitive market or monopoly or any kind of stuff, there are going to be some sort of competition, and there will be some people who are more desperate, saying making less fair deal. And how are we going to protect those people? And even though there is like policy, currently there are people who's doing the sex trade illegally. What will make them following the policy? And I'm losing track. And such. And second one is, I see sex trade as men buying girl, basically. Of course, there will be any other like outliers or something, but it's essentially one group with money asking the other group for service. Currently, Canada is already like having some struggle with gender equality, and I think suffering those sex trade would only making the gender equality more, creating more gaps in the gender equality. And cause another more mess, I would guess.
So thanks for that. I don't know whether there's anything, I mean, that's a good comment. I don't know whether there's much more to be said. I think most of you have already talked about how the legal approach is not going to get us to where we want to be, and I think this gentleman's pointed that out in a different way. Jamie, you wanted to add something?
Well, I'm a little uncomfortable with the notion that that gender equality is caused by prostitution, or that it leads to more gender inequality. I think gender inequality comes about from a lot of historical, political, economic, cultural backgrounds. And the way in which sex work plays out within those different contexts is influenced by the gender relations and the gender and gender power relations rather than the reverse. I think the form and how prostitution and sex work looks reflects the ambient gender relations and gender power relations more than influencing it.
Thank you. We really haven't discussed at all transnational movement of women and really forced sexual slavery almost. And do we need laws to try to reduce that? Secondly, the whole power relationship, I think the data is reasonably robust, at least in parts of the world, that again, the power relationship that men have over girls, sugar daddies, people in positions of authority that take advantage of those positions. Again, do we not need laws to try to minimize these, whether it's within our own profession as a physician? I mean, we are very strict about stepping over those boundaries because we know that human nature being what it is, that we will do so. So we have laws. I just want to raise both those.
Thanks, Alan. So for people who may not know, Alan Ronald, emeritus professor, no, emeritus, still continuing, involved in the university in many ways, and for many years involved in the stream of research that Jamie's now involved in. Comments, responses?
I just wanted to say that again, and it kind of goes back to one of the questions that was up there as well. You know, these inequitable gendered relations or the power that men have over women and girls' bodies. We're discussing this all after the fact. And I think that we really need to look at when we, because somebody had mentioned prevention, I think you had mentioned prevention. And, you know, throughout this discussion and throughout a myriad of other discussions when we talk about prostitution or, you know, the sex trade, the main piece that's kind of omitted from this is men. And really, again, men are the demand of this. They're the demand side of this. And if there was no demand, then whether or not we can continue to argue the argument of choice or non-choice, if there was no demand, nobody would have a choice anyways, or a seemingly choice. I think that we need to go back and we need to engage from very, very young our men. I would disagree that it's not in our human nature. When I gave, and I know I keep talking about my children, but I always share this story that when I had my first son, and who was 10 pounds, and he was cut out because that sucker wasn't coming out. And you know, you're frozen all the way down and you just kind of want to collapse. But I remember when the nurses brought my son to me and they brought him to the side of me. And I remember looking into my son, who was not even 2 minutes old. And my first thought was, I'm looking into the eyes of Creator. This is the closest that as human beings we will ever come to meeting Creator. My son, a male, it's not in his human nature to now, when he's older, go and seek out the sexually exploited women and girls. We really have to start engaging truthfully, courageously, men and boys. So, it's kind of what you were saying, but, you know, if you were to talk to my boys, one is 19, in his second year of university here, wants to be a lawyer, and my 12-year-old, who thinks he's bloody 19, but they could tell you about the history of sexual exploitation on Indigenous women and girls, because I've raised them to understand that and to position themselves so that they respect women and girls' bodies in everything that they do.
Hi. Is this on? I'm a sex worker. I know there's others of us in this room. There's a lot of people talking about us without our voices being included in the conversation. I am not exploited, and when I see clients, they are not inflicting violence upon me, although I do know that because of the current legal status and social status of sex workers, I am at a higher risk of being the victim of violence. But seeing my clients is not an act of violence on their parts. It's a job just like any other for me. Some days it's great, some days it sucks. I chose to do this job out of a small range of really imperfect choices, but I'm here by choice because I have agency. Even if I have very few choices, I still get to choose how I live my life. It would be really nice to hear more sex workers' voices actually being listened to in this dialogue, and to not have all of us being characterized as exploited victims who have no agency, who have no choices, who need to have their choices removed from them by having our livelihoods taken away from us by reducing or eliminating demand. This is probably one of the better jobs I've had. It's probably one of the less exploitative jobs I've had. I'm my own boss. I get to choose which hours I work. I get to decide which clients I see. If somebody is being inappropriate, I can kick them out. I realize I come from a fairly privileged place to have those options available to me. Though I find that a lot of the discourse around sex work seeks to invalidate or eliminate the voices of anyone who is not in the absolute worst case scenario. I started doing sex work because I was at risk of homelessness and I needed to make some money quick. So take what you will from that, but this is not exploitation for everyone. It is a choice for some people. Those who do not have a choice should be given more options, but eliminating more choices and an industry that primarily provides income for women and marginalized people is not the answer.
So thanks for that. We're getting close to the end. We've got maybe time for one or two more contributions. Miranda?
There's a question in here. Did you want to ask?
Hmm.
I had a question and I forgot what it was now.
All right, we'll go. We're running out of time, so we'll go somewhere else.
My question is mostly directed at Ms. Fontaine, but other members of the panel can feel free to contribute. If it is incumbent on us as parents to teach our sons about the exploitation that can be implicit in some situations in sex work, is it incumbent on me as a parent to teach my daughter about the possible exploitation involved in going to ladies' night at the Greenbrier or any other strip club in the city? And furthermore, is it appropriate for us to continue to pretend as if the buyer-seller relationship always goes the male as buyer and the female as seller? Is that an appropriate conclusion to draw in every situation?
Of course not. I mean, I'm sure that in cases there are women that are buyers, but even the young men or men and boys are exploited by men. Predominantly, it's men that do the exploiting, and in many respects, married men. In respect of raising your daughter, I'm sorry, I wasn't entirely sure. I don't have a daughter. All I know is how to raise my sons, and all I know is how to raise them to respect women's space and bodies. So I apologize, I kind of didn't understand your question about, and I don't drink, so I don't really go out, so I don't even know what that is, so.
Ladies' night at the Greenbrier is when the male dancers go out and dance for the ladies instead of the women dancing for the men, to clear up that misconception.
I wouldn't do that either, but that's just me.
But in any case, I think it's a little strange that we talk about it in that context always, when it's coming from the perspective that sex work is something horrible that needs to be abolished. When that's not always the way it goes.
Well, you know, I would argue that, and again, I know I'm not the most popular tonight, and that's fine, but, you know, the lobbying for the abolition of prostitution or the sex trade in Canada, I would say for that, the women, Indigenous women and girls, who ended up getting murdered, I think they'd have probably, and their families would have a very different perspective on this. And so like, we're just to be clear, we didn't organize the panel. And so I know that there's discourse on having a woman up here to have that part. I would also say that if we were gonna, you know, have another woman up here to discuss sex work, then we'd also have to have an Indigenous woman or an Indigenous family that has suffered the most savage violence in the context of prostitution or the sex trade.
Can I add a comment to that as well?
Briefly.
So there are a number of Indigenous groups across the country who have supported the decriminalization push. The Sex Workers United Against Violence Society, based in the downtown east side of Vancouver, is almost exclusively a group of Indigenous outdoor sex workers. And they work with Pivot Legal Society and have been for the last almost 10 years. Aboriginal Legal Services of Toronto also supported the push to decriminalize, and the Native Youth Sexual Health Network is another group that has come forward to do so. There's also a new group that's trying to put together a database of missing and murdered Indigenous women, a comprehensive database of missing and murdered Indigenous women from across the country. This group is based in Toronto. It's an Indigenous-run group. It's headed by Audrey Huntley, and it's called No More Silence. So really, what we are presenting to you this evening are three different perspectives based on research and experience, but we want to emphasize that there are multiple experiences and multiple voices, many different perspectives on sex work from Indigenous communities, from research communities, from feminist communities. So what you're getting is a small snapshot, and as the sex workers in the room have pointed out, we don't have a sex worker on this panel either. I also want to acknowledge how brave it is and how hard it is to come out in a room full of people as a sex worker. So, nice job.
Thank you for that. This brings us to the end of the evening. My own personal experience of this evening I find, to try and step out of it and observe it, very interesting. My parents, were they still alive, and if they could be here, would be shocked that I would be participating in a conversation on this topic, because it would be something that for them was unacceptable to do and unacceptable to talk about. And I think for many of those, for reasons that derive from that, we have in our country a situation that none of us think is good, and unfortunately a law in front of us that most people who understand the law don't think is going to make it any better. Ask you to each reflect on your own personal experience of the evening. I think it's better for us to talk, even in an imperfect conversation, and see if we can make some progress towards a better world. So I want to thank the panelists, and I want to thank all of you who came tonight. Encourage you to check out after the conversation page on the university's website, as well as UM Today for a recap of this evening. And think about coming next month on Wednesday, November 26th, for the next in our Visionary Conversation series. The topic will be a culture of conflict. What have we learned about war? Again, with a reception at 6:30 outside this room, and the panel discussion at 7. Hope it'll be another lively and important discussion. We'd love to see you here. Thanks again for coming tonight, and we look forward to seeing you on future events.